try this new experience. Can't see a thing, but I'm going in.
Hi folks, it's Hatch here from the trail, part 38. And hey, I've got a really neat thing happening today. I've got a dear friend from a long time ago at the Daily Camera newspaper, Julie Poppin, and she's here with a very interesting, awesome device that she's gonna tell you a little bit about. Here's Julie.
Hello.
Hi, Julie.
Hello, John. How are you doing?
Good. Welcome to 2020.
Yeah, finally some snow. We're happy.
Yeah, we are happy, and we've been waiting for the snow, and I can tell you why I've been waiting for the snow especially is to get with Julie, because Julie has a very, very cool device that I think many of you will be interested in and actually remember. And that was a sneak peek. Julie's got this really cool thing called the Snurfer, and she's about to tell you all about it.
Okay, well, I'm holding two because one's for you and one's for me, John. But anyway, very cool story. So on Christmas Day 1965, my dad, Sherman R. Poppin, invented what is known as the Snurfer. So some of you who grew up on the coasts and were young people in the 60s and 70s may remember these and having a lot of fun on these in the snow. The Snurfer is pretty much the precursor to the modern day snowboard. Jake Burton Carpenter would come to our annual snurfing competitions in Western Michigan, and the Snurfer was always faster than his early boards, but he loved snurfing. He had a Snurfer, and then he ended up modifying the board and really bringing it into what it is today, along with some other early snowboarders.
Julie, what's like the main difference between this board and Jake's Burton
board?
Oh
yeah, well, there's actually a lot of differences. For one thing, it's skinny. As you can see, it's really, early ones were really more like a water ski. So they're skinny and there are no actual bindings. But what's interesting is this whole free snowboarding thing without bindings is actually like really kind of popular again now. So, and then there's a tether. Whoops, so your main control was, you know, hanging on for dear life to the tether. These things are really fast, they're hard to turn. So maybe some turning because there's this metal skeg here to give you a little bit of control. But
oh, there really is a metal skeg down there.
This is the racing model, John. So
it
this
is,
you know, the fancy racing model. And so some people really figured out how to turn them and did it in powder in the Rocky Mountains, which is pretty much insane. But anyway, yeah, and my mom came up with the name Snurf, a combination of the words snow and surf.
Snurf, okay.
Yeah, and really it was because of me that snowboarding exists, because I was a blue baby, so to speak, incompatible blood type with my mother. And she was, you know, due to have me born early on December 28th, and it's Christmas Day, and my older sisters, Wendy and Lori, 5 and 10 years old, were running around the house, you know, playing their new instruments and eating candy or whatever, driving everyone crazy. And my mom told my dad, you know, get those girls out of the house and play. And so, you know, he took them outside and tried to stand on sleds and do different things, and it wasn't working. And then my dad had the brilliant idea of getting my big sister's two little wooden skis and attaching them with a crossbeam. So if these were two skis, little kids' wooden skis, he put two like connectors here and here and foot grips. And all the kids in the neighborhood in Western Michigan, Muskegon, Michigan, were going crazy and having fun. And then my dad was like, huh, I could do something with this. And we had Brunswick Corporation in our town of the bowling balls and the bowling alleys. And so they had the equipment to kind of make the type of wood. Although having said that, these were not made by Brunswick. This is another company, Gem, that did it later. These are the end days Snurfers in the 80s or 70s. But anyway, so then the executives came from Chicago to check them out from Brunswick, and they're like, great. And they started making them and sold quite a few for a pretty short period until the snowboard really took off, the modern day snowboard. But,
so what year was this, 80s?
Well, 1965 started, and I'd say they really started fizzling out in the definite early 80s. Uh-huh. You started to see the early snowboards, and the Snurfer kind of just faded away.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well,
but
why?
Someone new is making them in Vermont now. But they're, you know, back in the day they were really cheap. Now they're a bit more expensive, over $100, I think. But why did they fizzle out?
We'll see the Snurfer too.
Yeah, no, it exists.
Yeah, what was it? Was it the...
Just the snowboards became popular. Yeah. And I think that, you know, one of the complexities of marketing this was, is it a toy? Is it a sport? You know, where do you sell it? They weren't really sold in the right stores, maybe. I think it was cited as a disastrous business, you know, example from the Harvard or Business School or something like that. I don't know, one of them. Maybe not Harvard. Anyway, you know, I think it just, you know, it got pushed aside by the what you could do with a snowboard with more control. And, you know, it is, you'll see when you do it, there's a slightly awkward pose when you're doing this. But it's fast and it's fun.
Does anybody ever come up to you and recognize you as a Snurfer bunny?
No. Only maybe today. I have brought, you know, I'm not recognizable, but I have brought these around town occasionally, rarely, and I've had people come up and go, oh, I had one of those when I was a kid, you know.
Julie, I wish I could remember who it was. It was probably my friend Peter Diller, who had a Snurfer in his yard.
Yeah.
But it was lighter colored.
Well, the regular model was yellow, so it was recognizable. Yellow wood and with the tether. And it didn't have the metal thing here. And then this was, again, the more racing model. Earlier versions too had like staples for foot grips, but they always kind of maintained the same general vibe.
Well, let's go take a ride.
Let's do it. Oh, I don't know about that.
And then we'll do it together.
All right. That's a great one. So my dad passed away in March, that's his birthday, July 31st of 2019. So that was sad, but it caused a lot of reflection on the Snurfer and snowboarding. And I should say he will be inducted into the U.S. Ski and Snowboarding Hall of Fame in March, his birthday week, when he would have turned 90. Which is really exciting. So we'll be there in Sun Valley. I'm just sorry that it happened when he's not here. But very awesome nonetheless. And, you know, he was a very much like a can-do person. Never found a hole he didn't want to drill. Didn't like directions. Liked solving problems, making things happen. Plus he was a very active person. Skiing, sailing, running, tennis, you know, racquetball, whatever it was over the years. So like this kind of put all those things together, and you know, he just thought it was fun. He was an inventor. He liked innovating and coming up with new ideas, and turned this into something. But it was never his full-time gig. He worked for a welding supply company. You know, he was always in the dad. So like it was a side thing that was fun. And but then, you know, I think he really got a bang out of it when snowboarding took off. And he was a lifelong skier, picked up snowboarding in his 60s, and then really got into it for a good 10, 20 years until he couldn't do it anymore. And he retired in Steamboat Springs, Colorado, and he would always like try to get on the mountain the number of days of his age. So, you know, 70 days on the mountain, whatever. And so he loved, once he picked up snowboarding, he never looked back. He loved it. He described it as a real Zen experience. And he'd go to some of the big snowboarding conventions and stuff. And he just loved the energy and spirit of all the people that he met. So he really enjoyed that, the whole thing. Yeah.
Okay, Julie Poppin, how'd we do?
Hey, we did great.
Did I do all right?
You did for a first. Well, no, you've done it before, but that was over 30 years ago.
Had to be 40.
I think you did a fine job.
38 to 40 years ago at Pete Diller's backyard.
Fine job.
That brought me back. Thank you so much for introducing this to some folks who may not remember the Snurfer. Sorry, I don't mean to
hit
you.
That's okay. I'm putting mine in there, yep.
But I think it's just awesome that you were able to stop for a minute and join me.
Yeah.
And have,
You want to try it, come find me because I have a few in the garage.
Yeah, that goes to all you out there. Don't forget to have your sunglasses.
Oh, yeah.
Any parting words?
Yeah, yes. That I think the beauty of this whole thing is that anyone can do it. And just even with sledding, this beautiful winter day, this is free. You come out and you enjoy yourself in this beautiful winter weather. So yeah. Anyone can do it, and everyone is here today at this little sledding hill, which gives me, you know, makes me feel good.
Yeah, the snurfer may come alive again after all.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate it. I'm grateful for your time.
Yeah.
And as I always end every segment with, I always have to say, don't forget to smile.